Good afternoon. As you know, I'm the U.S. Ambassador to Libya. I resided in Libya until late December 2010. You all know the circumstances under which I left. I'm not here to discuss these circumstances. I'm here to discuss the situation in Libya today and what the United States and its coalition partners are doing to stop the brutality and bloodshed of the Gaddafi regime, bent on denying its people universal rights that are the birthright of people everywhere. My embassy team was evacuated from Libya on February 23rd and has been reconstituted in Washington. They're playing an active role in providing information, analysis, and assistance based on their experience. At best, we are trying to find clarity about a place that in the best of times can only be described as opaque. Now it is exponentially more difficult, as you all know, including your own personal experiences, to get the kind of precise information that we would like. Let's discuss how we got here. On February 17th, a brave group of Libyan citizens decided that they no longer wanted to live under a repressive regime which denied them their most basic universal rights for over 41 years. In response to the Libyan people peacefully protesting for their universal rights, the Gaddafi regime unleashed a bloody wave of violence and oppression, slaughtering its own citizens. The consequences of those barbaric actions was the exodus of tens of thousands of Libyans and foreigners, and we in the international community rushed at first instance to provide assistance at the Tunisian and Egyptian borders. Since that time, we have provided humanitarian assistance, we've helped those workers get back to their countries, and we continue to provide humanitarian assistance to the people of Libya. The Libyan people appealed to the world to help stop these barbaric attacks, and the international community spoke with one voice to condemn them and to respond. The Arab League and the GCC called for urgent action, and the UN Security Council mandated all necessary measures to protect civilians, including a no-fly zone. We also implemented, we the United States, our own unilateral response, including sanctions to the Gaddafi's regime's atrocities. It became clear that Gaddafi and his henchmen had no intention of ceasing the violence and bloodshed, and as the Secretary said last night, we faced the prospect of an imminent humanitarian catastrophe in Benghazi. By his words, by his actions, and certainly by his past deeds, we had to take Gaddafi at his word when he threatened to go house to house and to wreak revenge against the people of Benghazi. The international coalition was compelled to act. The coalition's effort over the past week garnered the support and the active participation of nations who recognize the significance of coming together in the international community to address the situation in Libya. The Libyan people must be allowed to have a voice. Ultimately, it is the Libyan people themselves who will forge the path forward for Libya. Our immediate goal is to ensure we provide the humanitarian assistance and protection they need in order to achieve their aspirations. Thank you.
Bring us up to date on your contacts or other U.S. officials' contacts with the opposition since that first meeting in Paris between the Secretary and Mr. Jibril. And tell us if you are at all closer to making a decision on whether to follow the lead that France so helpfully started out a couple weeks ago now in recognizing them as the legitimate government.
Since the beginning of the crisis, when we saw that the Council had constituted itself as some kind of temporary governing body, I and certainly members of my staff recognized that some of those people were people that we had dealt with during our tenures in Libya. And so that right from the start, I had been reaching out to the leaders of the Council. And since that time, since the embassy was reconstituted here, as I said, we had extensive dealings and contacts through our various programs, especially educational programs, with the people of the East. I had a very active public affairs section in Libya, and they were always communicating with the doctors and jurists and people who, in fact, now are part of the Council. So we had a good in to those people. Since the secretaries, we've been gradually stepping up our contacts with them on a daily basis, and certainly you're all aware that the secretary in Paris last week met with Mahmoud Jibril, a very prominent former official in Libya. He was the head of the National Economic Development Board, a think tank, as it were, which was in the forefront of trying to institute, recommend economic reform in Libya. And he has since been named as the one of the two co-coordinators of the council to the international community. So we have been, as I said, in contact with them constantly. I would say that just in terms of my own contacts with them as well, if you look at what they have done from the start, I think they have been, they moved in a very positive direction. From the beginning of the crisis, they organized local groups in the various cities that were freed from Gaddafi's regime. It was a grassroots movement. They organized people at the start to, for example, take care of the garbage, take care of electricity, take care of water in those various cities. And then from a grassroots movement, they then elected their representatives to the main council, a body of 31, which now calls itself the Transitional National Council. They appealed for humanitarian aid. They appointed representatives right from the start because they knew that they had to deal with the international community, and they appointed Mr. Jibril as well as Ali Asawi, the former ambassador to India. In addition to that, they have they've been very careful about trying to get the right messaging across to the international community. I hope that some of you have seen at least some of the documents that they have produced over the past several days. Number one of them basically welcoming the coalition efforts on their behalf to protect them from the ravages of the Gaddafi onslaught. Second, they were talking about the disparaging of the claims by the Gaddafi regime in the beginning that the coalition efforts and bombings were resulting in civilian casualties. And third, they called upon other members of the international community to help them. Since that time, they've also published several documents, one of which I think was about 3 days ago, talking about their vision of what a future Libya would look like. And it had all the right elements in it in terms of human rights, in terms of women's rights, in terms of equal participation. It was really a very, very good document. So I think that from what we know and what we've seen over the past month, I think they're off to a good start. That's not to say that we know everything about them. We don't. And we have to be very careful about, you know, who might be included in the future and how they go about forming a government if, in fact, they have that opportunity. So we're not Pollyannish about saying that we know everything about who we're dealing with. But I can say that based on the experience that we've had so far, they are off to a good start in word and deed and do not seem to be, at least in the statements and the actions that they've taken, in any way incompatible with the kind of ideals that we would be advocating, you know, in that situation.
Can you address Matt's question about recognition, whether you're any closer to making a decision on that?
We're still dealing with the recognition question. I think it's a, you know, there's elements of legality involved, there's elements of international law, but that has not stopped us from taking some very important steps. As you know, our embassy in Tripoli, when our staff left, we suspended operations. We did not break relations with the Gaddafi regime, but just recently we asked the Libyan embassy here to undertake the same step of suspending operations. We've named a special envoy who we hope will be able to get to Benghazi sometime when the security situation allows itself over the next several days. And I said we've the secretary stepped up the level of representation in terms of our discussions with the opposition. So I think we're without getting into the issue of whether recognition is a critical factor now or not, I think we've taken some steps that indicate our support for the opposition.
And one other thing, beyond humanitarian assistance, what if any, tangible assistance is the U.S. government giving the opposition? Are you, for example, reaching out to try to help them think about how they might form ministries or how they might seek to govern some part of Libya or perhaps ultimately all of Libya? Are you doing any of that kind of work?
Yeah. We have basically been the array of options with respect to how we can help the council is being discussed in Washington. Nothing is off the table right now. We have made, I have made, you know, and several others from my team have made kind of informal proposals to the council that as it moves forward, should it require help in terms of shaping a constitution, in terms of any kind of assistance in the transformation of this kind of situation to a democracy or whatever we'll say might emerge out of this, we are willing to offer any kind of assistance they like. But we're going to make the offer, and then we'll wait and see exactly what they would like us to do, and then we'll determine that.
They haven't asked for anything yet.
Ambassador, can I ask you to take that a bit further? The opposition says that they are looking for that kind of political, you know, obviously the recognition, but political support that, you know, after the no-fly zone is set up, you could have a protracted situation where, you know, these people are in the East and trying to develop themselves. So they're asking for this type of political support for you. Do you have a plan for that? Is that something that Chris Stevens is going to be working on? And then also, because just to finish that point, I mean, you've said that although the military operation is not to get rid of Gaddafi, the president and the secretary have said that, you know, your political goal would be that he steps down from power. So how do you achieve that goal? And then there's talk, obviously, about an indictment possibly for Colonel Gaddafi in the International Criminal Court. Knowing what you do about the regime, do you see any situation where Colonel Gaddafi would step down from power and turn himself over to The Hague? And have you had any contacts, any further contacts with his inner circle? Thank you.
With respect to what are the potential needs of the council as they move forward in this transition period? Look, we've done a lot of discussions, and we've done a lot of begun to do some planning here under various scenarios that might emerge from the current situation. And certainly, in several of those scenarios, the idea that we might be able to help with some kind of political training, political offers, legal advice is part of that. And we certainly would make ourselves available with the full array of the different programs and the different departments that we have available throughout the U.S. government to them should they request that. The question of the ICC, I know that there, I think the ICC has begun an investigation. I'll leave it to them to determine what the case is against Gaddafi. I'm not going to speculate on what Colonel Gaddafi's intentions are with respect to staying in power or stepping down as a result of any of these actions. I mean, if 2 years of living in Libya taught us anything, it's not to speculate on the potential actions of any member of the regime, much less Colonel Gaddafi. With respect to my own contacts, I have had some limited contact with some of the regime members. Some have contacted me. I have contacted some of them, basically with the sole purpose, and this was during the last week, of ensuring that they had seen the president's comments last Friday and to make sure that they understood what was at stake, not only for the international community, but for themselves, and that they should look to the comments that the president made as a kind of a look not for whom the bell tolls, it tolls for thee kind of warning, and just to make sure that they understood what the full import of the president's message was.
The other day, the secretary spoke about members of the inner circle who are reaching out, trying to find a way out of the country. I was curious what you could tell us about any efforts to encourage members of his family, of his cabinet, to break ranks with him, and how you're helping that process go on.
Yeah, I mean, there have been, I think that someone mentioned here that there had been several contacts between members of the regime, like Musa Kusa and Abdullah Sanusi, to Assistant Secretary Feltman last week. It's clear that the regime is reaching out to several possible mediators, interlocutors, to try to get a message across. I'm not exactly sure what the message is, but it clearly indicates, I think, at least some kind of desperation, I think, at this point. But I can't get into the – we haven't really been involved in those kind of discussions up until now.
Yesterday, the former Libyan ambassador to the United States said that the opposition fighters need training, they need weapons, they need ammunition, and he basically made a case that the no-fly zone is going to come to nothing if they can't give these rebels enough material to take Gaddafi out somehow. And I mean, obviously, the opposition members are students and professors, they're not trained fighters, and he made that case very forcefully. There's seven members of the council are university professors, only three are generals. I mean, they need some he's making a powerful point about the need for military support in addition to the no-fly zone. Where do we stand on that?
Well, I'm not going to get into internal discussions we're having about whether we will provide arms or whether we won't provide arms. I can just say that the full gamut of potential assistance that we might offer, both on the non-lethal and the lethal side, is a subject of discussion within the U.S. government. But there has been no final decisions made on any aspect of
that
yet.
Do you agree with his assessment, though, that if essentially the no-fly zone could just create a stalemate? And
As I said before, there are several scenarios that are playing out. This is a very fluid situation. And it's very difficult to know which scenario is going to play out. Is it possible that it could result in a stalemate? That is one of the possibilities. There are several others as well. But I don't think that with this particular point anybody has any good insight, especially given how fluid the situation is with respect to how this is actually going to turn out.
Just a couple more questions, Sub, and then Mark.
When will the council give the rebels an address and make it speed up the delegitimizing of Gaddafi? Why the reluctance? And then I have a quick follow-up.
As I said before, I think that it's under advisement here. We are considering the issue of recognition, but it does it runs into several legal questions, several questions of international law, and there are other things that countries can do. Short of recognition at this particular point, and it's not prevented us from doing the things that we need to do with respect to showing our very, very strong support for the Council.
Mark?
There's been some reporting that suggests that as rebels have cleared out towns, they've actually put Gaddafi loyalists into the same jails that Gaddafi was using for his, that he threw opposition people into. And I wonder whether, notwithstanding what you said earlier about the good start the council's off to, are you troubled by anything you've seen on the part of the rebels in terms of their own behavior in the towns and cities that they've gone into? And then I guess to address, to put it in a broader terms, a lot of analysts will continue to say, we don't know anything about the rebels. Do you think that's a wrong statement?
With respect to the allegations of potential rebel atrocities, I guess you would call them, I don't have any information about that. We're very in our consultations with them. Like I said, we have been very strong in telling them you need to be careful with your, with your messaging. Who are you? Because this is part of the. Of their ability to influence the international community. I would hope certainly that those kind of things that you spoke about are not taking place, but time will have to wait and see if in fact they are, and then we'll have to deal with it. With respect to the opposition, the question was...
The question was, is it wrong when people say we don't know anything about who the rebels are?
You know, I think for the American people at large, the international community at large, let's face it, the information about Libya has not been widely disseminated. I mean, I was in Libya as of the end of December, and I still had very prominent businessmen calling me and asking if we still had sanctions on them. So I think if information about Libya is not clear, I don't think it's surprising that the average individual, or even the individuals in this room, or individuals in governments throughout the world, would have questions about who these people are. Like I said in the beginning, we know some of them. We're trying to get to know more of them. But I don't think we're at a point where we can make a judgment that this is a 100% kosher, so to speak, group. But like I said, the personalities that we are dealing with, the actions that they've taken, the statements that they have made, have all led us to conclude, at least at this beginning stage, that they are a positive force and ones that we should be engaged with at this point.
Mr. Ambassador, if you could talk a little bit about an Algeria-based terrorist group that it's in most recent iteration called Al-Qaeda in the Islamic Maghreb. What influence have they had in your time there, more recently in the past couple of months? And what concerns do you have about their infiltration as we move forward?
Well, it's clear that AQIM is a danger to the region. Certainly, we have worked closely with our fellow governments in the region to stop and to gather information about them and to stop any potential operations that they might carry out. From the start, when I first met with the representatives of the council, I said, they told me that they were aware that there could be a problem with AQIM trying to take advantage of the situation. After all, we don't know what the situation at the borders are, and it's possible in a situation like this that you could have some advantage, taking advantage. And in fact, they told me that at the very first week of the crisis, that there had been an effort by some AQIM members to infiltrate, but the council, in fact, had caught them. But it was maybe three or four at the time, so they're very aware of the problem. Colonel Gaddafi has used the AQIM card, in fact, to say, and this is in all the discussions that we've had, there has been an unrelenting litany ad nauseum that this is AQIM, this is not a homegrown, protest movement, and it's as a way to discredit and disparage the opposition. It's clearly a card that he thinks he might be able to get some benefit of. It's patently ridiculous. But do we have concerns about AQIM? Certainly we do. But I think the council is also aware of that as well.
Great. Last question, Nicole.
Hi, Mr. Ambassador.
Yeah.
Two things. You've said that you've offered the opposition / rebels all the help that, or any help that they might wish. Have they asked you for anything specifically? And secondly, have they been invited to take part in the meeting on Tuesday in London?
Since the beginning of the crisis, they have been clear that they would like recognition, certainly from the United States, from the international community. They have made requests for arms. They have made requests for a whole range of things. And on each of those issues, we have said that we would consider that, and in fact have provided some humanitarian support. And as I said, the other issues are still being discussed. Nothing is off the table at this particular point. With respect to whether they've been invited, that would be a question for our British hosts. I'm not sure that.
I'll ask them. But do you know?
Yeah, I don't know.
Might be there?
I do not know.
Okay.